ओम सदाशिव समारंभां शंकराचार्य मध्यमां अस्मदाचार्य पर्यन्तां वंदे गुरु परंपरां। ओम वी आर स्टडिंग द 8th चैप्टर ऑफ द भगवद गीता वेयर कृष्णा इज आंसरिंग अ क्वेश्चन बाय अर्जुन ऑन हाउ टू रिमेंबर गॉड एट द टाइम ऑफ डेथ एंड we are looking, this is an odd chapter in comparison to all the other 18 chapters which talk about what is called krama mukti rather than sadyo mukti. So Krishna is giving various upasanas for those who have not been able to achieve jivan mukti, and this part of the Bhagavad Gita is sometimes very explicit, where in some of the verses today he is going to really talk about the time of death. There is a nice verse which we'll be studying in our Sunday classes by Dhrida Bhakta, one of the students of Adi Shankara, who says, Bhagavad Gita Kinchida Dita. If you are able to study, understand, and follow the upasanas and the jnanam given in the Bhagavad Gita, what happens is Yama has no more business with you. You move out of that list. We are looking to see how we can get out of Yama Dharma Raja's list. As I want to recap, with the study of the Bhagavad Gita, as we look at our own death, we should see that death is not the enemy, it is a part of life. We should not think that death is against life, because wherever there is life, there is death. Look at a real plant, you will see while there is liveliness in the plant, simultaneously there are dead leaves and dead components within a plant, which is not there in a dead, in a plastic plant. Now, the more we understand life, the more we are able to understand death. And then we will see that death is not the opposite of life, they complement life. In our last class, we studied how breathing in is as important as breathing out, because you cannot be alive by breathing in alone. So even though breathing out seems to be a form of a death, if you want to lead a full life, you have to invest as much in dying, that is in breathing out, as much as in breathing in. If you study pranayama, if you study your own breath, you will live, you will understand that each moment of breathing in is life, and each moment is breathing out is death. That means we die moment to moment and we are born again and again to the present. We die to the past, we are born to the present. So the dictum is, where there is death, there is life. You will see it whenever you are taking risks, whenever you are gambling, whenever you are exposed to danger. We had this experience in our trek to Kailash. Whenever we are close to Mount Kailash, that is in the north face, I remember that particular night we had people amongst us whose oxygen saturation dropped to about 60. We were anticipating death. I mean, when you are close to something so exhilarating, when we are close to the fullness of life, we are also close to death. Now, we have to answer this question. All of us are afraid to die. But who is that in us that who is afraid to die? Now, because death is an integral process of life, life cannot be afraid of its own integral process. There must be something else in us who is afraid of death. And if you are able to make a diagnosis, that is going to help you. And the that person in us who is afraid of death is the ego. The ego is afraid to die. The ego wants my individuality to persist. And you will really see the ego is the one that is afraid to die. If you really look again, the ego is against life. The ego is against death. The ego is against both. The more you live life more fully, you become closer to death. That is why the ego does not allow you to live a fuller life. Whenever you do anything intensely, whenever you do anything passionately, you are so full of life. At that time, you see you're so full of death also. Wherever there is aliveness, there is death also too. That is why people are afraid to love, because in love, there is the death of the ego. Now, all spiritual sadhanas are therefore to work on the ego. Ramana has said in the Upadesha Sara, ahami nasha bhaji. The ahami means the small I. The ego needs to be destroyed. And when that is destroyed, aham taya spurati ritsvayam paramapurna sat. So the real sadhana is for the death of the ego, and that is possible through bhakti, that is possible through upasana. Let us listen intently to these verses, beginning with Dr. Vikram, who did. It's your time, Vikram.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
Yeah. Tasmat sarveshu kaleshu mama nusmara yuddha cha maya arpita mano buddhir mame vaishnavasya asam shaya. So here Krishna tells, therefore remember me all the time and fight with your mind and intellect fixed upon me. You will attain me alone doubtlessly. So, Arjuna, may you always remember me, then alone your subconsciousness will be saturated with my thought. So Arjuna again asks, how I have to remember the Lord all the time? Should I drop all the things and take sannyasa and from next day I will remember you only and I will not go for war? So Arjuna is trying to escape from the war. So that is the main intention of that. So Krishna knows that. Immediately he tells, you have to fight also. Means for Arjuna, he is advising to fight. But for us, is that we need to follow our Swadharma. So how we can do two jobs simultaneously? That is the question. Means how to fight and how to remember the Lord also. So for that he tells, conscious mind cannot do two jobs simultaneously. The conscious mind will be committed to only one thing. But even when conscious mind is dedicated to some work, in the subconscious mind, in the background, we need to have a clear priorities of life. Usually in the subconscious mind, we generally worry. Swamiji gives an excellent example of a train journey. When we go in the train, in between some station, we get down and buy something. But in back of the mind, we'll always know that we have to reach a destination. So similarly in life, we have to do everything. We have to earn money, get married. Swamiji tells it is nothing wrong. But main thing is we should not forget the primary goal. So we have to depend emotionally. We should depend on God. And because if we depend on mortals, they will be short term. And again, many problems will start. So, and physical, personal, God symbolizes the truth, symbolizes immortality. It symbolizes love, compassion, steadiness. Therefore, the physical form, Swamiji says, is not the ultimate truth, but the physical form represents the highest reality. And this is called intellectual conviction. Therefore, be emotionally hooked to Ishvara, be intellectually convinced. If you follow this lifestyle, you will certainly attain me alone. Again, Krishna gives the guarantee. So again, Swamiji used to tell that spiritual journey is not a part-time job. It is full-time preoccupation. Thank you.
Thanks, Vikram. Simple and a clear-cut explanation of this important verse, how to remember God all the time. Prakash, it's your time.
Guru Bhyo Namaha. Doctor, are you able to hear me?
Very clear. Go ahead.
Abhyasa yoga yuktena chetasa nanya gamina paramam purusham divyam yati partha nu chintayan. This is what Lord Krishna is talking to Arjuna. Anuchintayan purusham, constantly talking of the Lord. Chetasa, with a mind. Nanya gamina, undistracted. Abhyasa yoga yuktena, due to the constant practice of meditation, one attains divyam, the divine, paramam, the supreme. O Arjuna, constantly thinking of the Lord with the mind that is undistracted, due to the practice of meditation, one attains the divine supreme Lord. Prayana Kale, at the time of death, a Saguna Upasaka, Anuchantayan, remembers the Lord, what type of Lord? Purusham Divyam, the Lord which is the highest reality, and the Lord who is known as Purushaha. Purushaha, the word has two meanings. One meaning is Puri, Sheti, Iti Purushaha, the one who resides in the hearts of everyone, or Puri, or pure, means the body. Sheta means dwells, resides, Purushaha, the indweller of all. And the second meaning is Puriyati, Puriyati Sarvam Iti Purushaha. Puriyati means the one who spreads, the one who fills up the whole world. From the only the word Puram, Purnam comes Puram, Purnam. So all that pervading indweller who is Paramam, the absolute reality. Divyam means the one who is Chaitanya Swarupam. So that Lord, a Saguna Upasaka, remembers at the time of death how? Jetasa, with a mind, what type of mind? Abhyasa Yoga Yuktena, which has the strength of a practice, regular exercise, because the mind is able to do. Because of the regular rehearsal, Abhyasa means what? Practice, repetition. Abhyasa Yogena means the sadhana of Abhyasa. As it is told, practice makes a perfect man. So the practice is called Abhyasa of Yoga Yuktena, a mind which is endowed with strength of practice, the support of practice with such a mind, and therefore only Nanya Gamina, with the mind which is undistracted, and with such a mind, the Saguna Upasaka remembers me. And Yati, it is very, very natural. It is not anything extraordinary. We have heard of that Ramanujam, a mathematician. Swamiji gives an example. At his deathbed, he was asked about the number of a car. When he said the number, he said, this is only the number which has got two different cube roots for form at that time of death. He remembers the uniqueness of the car number. I forget. He very clearly, this goes to say that it is because of Abhyasa. How he is able to do that? Because the Abhyasa Yoga Yuktena. So whatever you love, your mind automatically thinks of it, tends to think of it. If you have valued the highest truth, then you should think of that which is represented of God. And thinking of that God, Yati, means he remains to attain or merge into the Lord. He merges into God. And the merger into God means Krama Mukti. Thank you, Doctor.
Thank you, Prakash. Excellent presentation. How many times you practice this? Because it is a product of Abhyasena. You know, everything comes with practice, and that is why Sri Krishna keeps saying, unless you keep practicing God's name all the time, at the time of difficulty, you will not be able to. So that is the importance of Abhyasa. Very nice explanation. Vishwanath, it is your time.
And one example you gave about, a long time back, in one of the talks you told, a small child who has a toy, who enjoys it, playing with it. And if he has played totally with it, he doesn't mind losing it or destroying it. But if it is kept on a showcase or something, he definitely feels that he is losing something. Death is also like that.
Yes.
If you have your life purely, fully.
Yeah, yeah. Now it's Vishwanath's time. We'll go to Vishwanath.
Okay. So we continue to discuss all the way till verse 14, the seventh question that Arjuna is asking. Just as a reminder, seventh question is, what is the significance of remembering the Lord at the time of death? Prayana Kale Ishvara Smarana. I'll go to the verse proper. Kavim Puranam Anusa Sitaram अणोराण्यं सम अनुस्मरेद्यः सर्वस्य दातारं अचिन्त्यरूपं आदित्यवर्णं तमसा परास्तत्। One who thinks of the Lord at the time of death attains the Lord, who is omniscient, the ruler of all, subtler than the atom, the sustainer of all, the giver of fruits of action, incomprehensible, effulgent like sun, and beyond the darkness of ignorance. Now, in this sloka, Lord Krishna describes 8 attributes of Lord who is remembered, who are supposed to be remembered by a Nishkama Upasaka at the time of death. This is a very straightforward verse with these 8 attributes. And each word in this verse is an attribute of the Lord. One interpretation Swami Param makes out of this verse is that Nishkama Upasaka probably would have been in touch with scriptures, because these attributes are all technical terms, and that's the only way he would know these technical terms. So let's go to these 8 attributes. Kavim means who is omniscient, sarvajna, all the illuminating principles, because Lord is seen as the total mind. Puranam, ageless, timeless, and most ancient one, the one who is never created, the one who is the creator of everyone. Here, Puranam is an adjective, and we should not misinterpret this to our scriptures, Puranam, because it's a time principle. Anusasitaram means the one who gives the karma phala to all the jivas, is karma phala data, according to the laws of karma. When we talk about the laws of karma, it is not only the physical laws, but moral laws also. In keeping with the laws of karma, one gives the karma phalam. Aniyasam anoha, subtler than the atom, the one who is subtler than even the subtlest atom, which means one who is not available for any sense perceptions. So, one who is beyond shabda, sparsha, rupa, rasa, gandha. So, from this, it's very clear that the physical form that we attribute to the Lord is only symbolic. Swami Param gives a India national flag example. The flag represents India, but flag is not India. Similarly, God is with form, represents formless reality, formless immortality, formless space, formless security. In fact, everything we seek in life is symbolized as God. These are the things that we seek. We seek peace, security, fullness, and all the abstract goals. These abstract goals are symbolized as physical God. Therefore, anoha anyasma sam means the real nature of the God is formless or formlessness. Dataram sarvasya, the sustainer of all, the one who is substratum, the support of entire creation, being the cause of the creation, just as ocean is the substratum of all the waves and bubbles. They rise and they fall, and they resolve into the ocean. Similarly, Lord is Vishwa Adharam, and in Vedantic context, we use word Sadrupam, Satta, the one who is existence principle. Achintya Rupam, incomprehensible, the one who is incomprehensible, the one who is beyond thoughts, the one who cannot be objectified by the mind. The reason why it cannot be objectified by the mind, because mind can visualize only the attributes of any object. Mind cannot function in the field where there are no attributes. Last two attributes, Aditya Varnam, this is effulgent like sun, the one which is who is bright like sun, the one who is illuminator of everything like sun. Just as sun illuminates, God is that one consciousness which is everything. Parastat tamasa, beyond ignorance, which is unaffected by even darkness. This is the difference between the sunlight and the Atma Jyoti. The fundamental difference is sunlight can illumine everything, but it cannot illumine itself, whereas Atma, all pervading conscious, can illuminate everything. Such a God, Nishkama Upasaka meditates. Anusmaret Yaha means, Yah here means Nishkama Upasaka, and Anusmaret means repeatedly remembers, not only throughout the life, but at the time of death also. Hari Om.
Thanks, Vishwanath. A lot of attributes, a very beautiful verse, which explains the form of the Lord. Particularly that last word, parastat tamasaha. Parastat tamasaha means the previous verse said it illumines like, it's like the sun, but the sun cannot illumine darkness. Like, I do not know Chinese, but I know that I do not know Chinese. Thanks, Vishwanath. We go to the next speaker, Madhu. Madhu, it is your time.
Yes, sir. Thank you. Am I audible?
Clear, very clear.
प्रयाण काले मनसा चलेन भक्त्या युक्तो योगबलेन चैव दुवोर् मध्ये प्राणमावेश्य सम्यक् सह तं परं पुरुषम् उपैति दिव्यम्. इट्स अ ब्यूटिफुल वर्स कवर्ड इन 8.10. इफ ऐ जस्ट कवर दिस अट् अ जिस्ट लेवल, अट् द टाइम ऑफ डेथ हैविंग प्रॉपरली ब्रॉट द प्राण बिटवीन द ऐब्रोस By the power of yoga, with an undistracted mind endowed with devotion, one attains the divine supreme Lord. It is so cleanly written and then it shows what will you achieve by doing what, and hence what is the mode of reaching that Ishwara Smarana. Word by word, Pada Parichaya is Prayanakale, at the time of death, Samyak Aveshya Pranam, having brought the prana, Madhye Bruvoho, between the eyebrows. Yoga balena eva, by the power of yoga, achalena manasa, with an undistracted mind, bhaktyacha yuktaha, endowed with devotion, saha upaiti, one attains tam divyam, that divine, param purushaha, supreme Lord. As we heard from earlier speakers, and also the preamble given by Dr. Hegde sir, Chapter 8 is also known as Akshara Brahma Yoga, which in itself is part of Madhyama Shatka alongside Chapter 7 through Chapter 12. In this particular sloka, Krishna dwells clearly here about Nishkama Upasaka, which basically talks very, very important spiritual sadhana, which is Upasana. Here again, as we all know, it's no news to anyone. There are two types of upasana. One is Sakama Upasana, which focuses pure material benefits, Ihaloka as well as Paraloka. Nishkama Upasana, without aspirations of the material benefit. The major focus here is the inner growth and the spiritual growth. Coming back to the verse itself, where Krishna dwells again on Nishkama Upasaka, remembering the God at the time of death. When it is Prayanakala, at the time of death, what does he do? Gruvor Madhye Pranamavesha. Prana here means this very life. This, in this sloka itself, while he touches upon how do you withdraw the prana and then bring it out at the time of the death itself, Swami Param refers here the Kathopanishad Mantra 16. Shatam Chaika Cha Hrudayasya Nadhya Stasam Murdhana Vinihi Srutaika Tatortva Mayan Namrutatva Meti Vishwananya Utkramane Bhavanti. The meaning being, without going into the verbatim of this sloka itself, he withdraws from every organ of the body and bring it to the Hrudaya, which is the center of the body. And from there on, he directs the whole prana through the special nadi called Sushumna Nadi, and then in turn through the Brahmarandra, and launches through a trajectory which is called a Shuklagati, in turn landing in Brahmaloka. So coming back to this, the question again rises back, which is exactly Arjuna also asked. The question is, how do I do it? How do I withdraw the prana? Krishna says, Yoga Balena Aiva, Yoga Balena Chaiva. What this means is that Yoga Balena Chaiva is one, controlling over the prana, withdrawal of the mind, and the directing the mind into that path of Shuklagati. If a person wants Krama Muktihi, this is one of the key aspects which one needs to be practicing. Not only he must be a Upasaka, he should also be practicing Ashtanga Yoga and Pranayama, which enables him to control the mind. Plus, in addition, he has to do manasa chalena. He must enjoy a mind which is very, very steady. At the time of death, he should be able to withdraw sukshma sharira, also with a balanced mind. Bhaktya yuktaha, he must be endowed with the total devotion towards me, intense urge to Ishwar prapti. Krishna beautifully concludes, what will he get by doing this yoga balena, by doing manasa with a stiff and the sturdiness in terms of the manasu and the bhaktya yuktaha. Saha param purushaha upaiti. He will attain the Lord himself. In this, every word of it has got a meaning and it has got so much of weight in every word. Purushaha here, he calls it as one who indwells in everyone, one who fills up with whole creation. Paramaha, one who is the highest, desha, kala, vastu, paricheda, shunyam, and one who is limitless. And divyam, one who is swayam prakasha chaitanya, and one who is the nature of consciousness. With such a Lord, what is it you are going to attain? Attain krama muktihi, goes to Brahmaloka, attend Brahmaji's classes, and finally attaining the moksha. Hari Om. Thank you, sir.
Thanks, Madhu. Very nice explanation of an important verse. But what this verse tells is, it is so difficult to do this. You have to be a great yogi and a great expert, and must remember that, Srinivas said that at the time of death, there is so much of pain and discomfort, like so many scorpions biting you. To remember all these things, perhaps this is one verse which tells you, better not pursue this. Rather, look for Sadhyo Mukti. Let us look for all the practices that we can do so that we attain to Jivan Mukta while alive, rather than take this last minute chance about the practice of the 10th verse. Dr. Suman, verse it goes for
you. Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Am I audible, sir?
Clear. Go ahead.
Okay. Yadaksharam Veda Vido Vadanti Vishanti Yatayo Vita Ragaha Yadi Chanto Brahmacharyam Charanti Tatye Padam Sangrahena Pravakshe. So the meaning is, I shall briefly declare to you that imperishable goal which the knower of the Vedas speak about, which the dispassionate sannyasis attain, and desiring which they live a life of brahmacharya. Here, Krishna speaks about upasakas who are 100% committed to liberation or Ishwara. First, we describe what committed means. Yadaksharam Veda Vido Vadanti. It's regarding those who study the Vedic scriptures and know Ishwara is the ultimate reality being Aksharam, the absolute reality, that which is imperishable. And also know that Ishwara is the only inexhaustible source of security, happiness, and fullness. Vishanti yat yataha. Those who pursue the spiritual goal single-mindedly and exclude every other thing are called sannyasa, where spirituality is the number one priority, not the external sannyasa. Thus, if your eye is 100% on spirituality, you are a sannyasi or a sannyasini. So what is their qualification? Vita ragaha. That means those who have turned away from finite goals or desires, because in time they have discovered the limitations of sukha dukkha. Thus, having realized all desires are apara prakriti, which will inevitably decay or degrade. God alone represents the para prakriti. Only para prakriti is worth summoning, worth calling, worshipping, and asking. So here, Swamiji gives the example of a cardboard chair, which you can handle, you can admire its beauty, and you can do everything, but you will not be able to sit on it. Similarly, everything in the creation you can handle, you can use, you can be nearby, except expecting emotional security from that. If you want security, that Aksharam alone can give. And therefore, these people understand the limitation, turn away from the finite, and turn towards the infinite one. Now, how is Upasaka changed by realization that only Ishwara is worth pursuing when we are alive? That is, Yadichanto Brahmacharyam Charanti. The Upasaka follows life of Brahmacharyam. He is committed to the study of scriptures. He is dwelling in the scriptures. Why do they dwell in scriptures? Because they have discovered that scriptures alone reveal and reinforce the ultimate reality. And this is the nature of Brahma. Aham samgrahena pravakshe. And Krishna says, I shall briefly define the nature of that Ishvara. And he promises to define the nature of Ishvara, but gives the definition in verses 20, 21, and 22 of chapter 8. Hari Om. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Suman, for a brief and a quick explanation of this important verse. We'll go to the next speaker, and that is Vinayakan.
Sir, am I audible?
Clear. Go Hello. Ahead. Go ahead.
So, Antakala Ishvara Smaranam is continuing at the time of death. So this 12th verse goes like this. Sarvadvarani samyamya manohrudi pranam nirudhyacha murdhnyayatmanaha pranam astito yoga dharanam. So here saguna upasana attributed upasana with attribute it's continuing. So God in his real nature is formless. Since it is difficult to conceive the formless God, the scriptures present a concrete symbol to visualize the formless God, which is called Alambanam in the Upasana. And Alambanam or symbol is of two types. One is called Pratima Alambanam and other is called Pratika Alambanam. Pratima Alambanam is a symbol which has got all the limbs, organs like head and hand, a rupam of Lord Rama or Lord Krishna, etc. So Krishna's description given in so many prayer verses like Megha Shyamam, Pita Kaushaya Vasam, etc. So this kind of varnana is called Pratima Alambanam. When the symbol does not have any organs or limbs, as just a word like Omkara or Shivalinga, that kind of Alambanam is called as Pratika Alambanam. And scriptures say you can't choose any you can choose any Alambanam you like. So Swamiji explains through a prayer verse like Shivasankara Ashtakam. Through that Ashtakam, the verse is Adibhishana Kadupashana Yamakinkara Petali Kridatadana Padibhidana Maranagata Samaye Umayasaha Manajayadasi Yamashasana Nivasan Harashankara Shivasankara Harame Haraduridam. So through this prayer verse, we are praying to Lord Shiva, that at the time of death, Yama Kingara is coming with so many threats and with so many noises and all. So at that time, O Shiva Shankara, you just come to my heart so that I can remember you. This is a booking prayer actually. So that is, this is Pratima Alambanam. So Pratika Alambanam is Omkara. And Omkara is explained in so many Upanishads like Kadha Upanishad, Mundaka Upanishad, and Taittiriya Upanishad, etc. In Kadha Upanishad, this is explained. This is explained as Edadalambanam Sreshtam, Edadalambanam Param, Edadalambanam Jnatva, Yodrichati Tasyadat, Edad Evaksharam Brahma, Edad Evaksharam Param. Here, this Evaksharam is Om. So, like that in Muntaka Upanishad, also it is explained as Pranavo Dhanusharo Hyatmaha, that Pranava Mantra, Om Mantra. So, Om symbol having so much of importance in our Vedanta and in our all scriptures. So Omkara Upasana is a kind of attributed Upasana. We can, if we are not like to like any God symbol and all, means you can, we can remember this Om or any kind of symbols, that is Pratika Alambana. So through this verse, first explain Sarvadvarani Samyamya. So at the time of Maranam, he has to withdraw all the sense organs. He has to shed all the sense organs. Why? Means this world, it is coming toward to inside our mind through the sense organs. So at the time of death, we should shed all the sense organs. And mana hrudi niruddhya, bring the mind to your heart in which the Lord is visualized. Murdhni atmana, pranam adaya. The prana should be withdrawn from their respective centers and it should be brought to the top of the head where the Sushumna Nadi emerges out. And yoga dharana astida, in the 10th verse it is there, yoga balena chaiva. So we should practice this ashtanga yoga, this yogic method also. one should practice the yogic concentration. Dharana means focusing, dwelling, concentrating, etc. It is possible only by earlier practice. Then, so a person should practice yoga dharana. So, in this Omkara Upasana also, we can meditate God at the time of death. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Vinayakan. You have brought so many aspects here, including all about Omkara from different Upanishads. And also about that very beautiful prayer that Swami Param says at the time of death, you know, when all the Yama Dutas come to visualize Shiva and Parvati dancing on your chest. I have personally seen so many people die, and I know what this verse 12 verse says. It is extremely, extremely difficult for anybody at this moment of death to do all these yogic practices to be able to attain to Krama Mukti. So I'd rather this group of all of us who are listening, work on while we are alive, study the Bhagavad Gita. Remember, Bhagavad Gita, Kinchit Adhita. Keep Yama Dharma Raja out of it so that we get Mukti and Jeevan Mukti while we are here. Dr. Narayan Murthy, your time, sir.
Yes, sir. Now we are in the middle shatkam of Srimad Bhagavad Gita, and as the director has mentioned, this eighth chapter, Akshara Parabrahma Yoga, is our man out when is no mention Brahma Gnanam. It is the Krama Mukti, a seeker who has been doing this bhavasana for the whole life, need not get disappointed, and he has got a solution. In the 10th sloka and it is little disappointing. Am I audible to everybody?
You are audible, but I would suggest you switch off your video so that the audio quality will be better.
Yes, sir. I have done it.
Go ahead.
So here, of two types, Sakama, we don't deal in this chapter, Sakama, Nishkama Upasana in two types. People, seekers, the mumukshus, who manage to proceed with this Upasana and attain maturity. Those two people are not able to proceed with Dhyana Yoga. It's till the end of the day. And so, hello. Not audible.
There is a disturbance in the audio, Dr. Murthy.
Lot of breaks in between.
Not able to hear now.
Go ahead.
Okay. Now, with this, there is a hope that these people who are not able to gain into the Jnana Yoga also get Mukti, but indirectly. They get a Krama Mukti. Hello.
Go ahead.
I will go through the sloka. Om itye kacharam brahma vyaharan ma manusmaran yah prayati yajam deham sayati paramam gati. These upasakas who have done the entire life upasana with a pratika, omkara. I will just mention the glory of omkara later, and they will leave the body uttering omkara, and they will travel in the to the brahmaloka in the shukla gati, and they will eventually get mukti. And here I would like to mention the glory of omkara. This omkara is pratika. It can be a transition from the Nirguna to Nirguna. So these Om are represent any attributes. So we can form a dance list from Saguna to Nirguna Upasana. And this Omkara is Upasana as a sadhana will end up with Kramamukti, whereas this Omkara Vichara will end up with Nididhyasanam of Jnana Yoga, which is dealt in detail in Mandukya Upanishad. And Lord Krishna has mentioned that he is Omkara among all the mantras. And Omkara is the condensed form of the essence of all Vedas. And Vedas in a condensed form is Omkara. When Omkara is expanded, it becomes Gayatri Mantra and other Upanishads. So it is Omkara is the Pranava Nada. It is a perfect name to represent Nirguna Brahman. So Omkara, and another thing during the explanation given by Swami Param, constantly a seeker who is total control of his senses can do mentioned in the Shloka 10 and 12, but those who are not able to do that due to some other reason, be unconscious, a comatose patient, comatose woman, also can attain this Shukrati because of interacting all things, good words, good habits. The conscious mind will definitely help him to proceed with the Shukla Gati. Hari Om.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Murthy. Final part we could hear. Dr. Rupa, it is your time.
Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. I'm audible, sir.
Very clear. Go ahead.
Ananya Cheta Satatam Yomam Smarati Nityasaha Tasyaham Sulabha Partha Nityayuktasya Yoginaha. The word translation of this verse. O Arjuna, I am easily available to that yogi who is ever steadfast and who constantly and continuously remembers me always with an undistracted mind. So continuing from the last verse, Arjuna asks Lord Krishna how all these things are possible at the time of death. For that, Lord Krishna answers in this verse. It is possible by sheer abhyasa or practice. What type of practice? To remember all the time that everything I am associated with belongs to the Lord alone. I have been given an opportunity to be with various people and learn to love them and take care of them. And when the time of separation comes also, my thinking is that everyone belongs to the Lord and therefore Lord has to take care of everyone and hand over everything to the Lord. Yoga Kshemam Vahamyaham. Lord Krishna says, Yamam Nityam Smarati. Suppose a person remembers me all the time and remembers God, and remember God represents totality only. Personal God is for convenience, but personal God also represents, what personal God also represents is the totality. Everything belongs to the macro. This is the awareness one should have. The one who remembers this fact that there is no individual separate from the total. There is no wave separate from the ocean. If the wave claims I have existence, it is the ignorance on the part of the wave. There is nothing separate from the ocean. Swami Param says, he repeatedly quotes this example many a time. What is this example? A wave is always permanently related to the ocean. A wave is fundamentally related to the ocean alone because it rises from the ocean, it exists in the ocean, and it resolves into the ocean. And not only in this birth, if the wave takes a punarjanma or rebirth, again, it is born out of the same ocean. And therefore, the wave's permanent relationship is with the ocean only. The relationship between any two waves is only temporary and incidental. In my preoccupation with incidental relationships, I should not lose sight of the fundamental. The fundamental relationship makes me a bhakta, whereas the incidental relationships makes me a husband, wife, father, mother, brother, sister, in-laws, etc. All these roles are essential. We need to play them, but not to forget that the fundamental is with the Lord alone. How? By ananya chetaha. This is a very important word in this verse to remember. Ananya means exclusively or no other. That is, without being distracted by or sidetracked by the incidental roles that I play. One has to remember me in the background all the time. To just have an example for this, how a musician while singing has his tambura shruti in the background all the time without losing track of it. If he loses track, then it becomes a music which is not nice to hear. Moving on, tasya, for such a nishkama upasaka. Hey Arjuna, aham sulabha, I am the easiest person to remember. Your mind remembers what you value most in your life. And nitya yuktasya yoginaha. It is easy for that upasaka who is ever integrated, ever balanced, ever clear about his principles in life. Here yoginaha is a seeker, and yogi means a upasaka yogi. In summary, Lord Krishna says that it is not just a devotion, but exclusive devotion to him that makes him easily available. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Rupa, for giving us an answer, a hope. So if you are able to constantly relate to God at the time of death, it should not be a problem. Whatever Krishna has given an advice, it could be possible. I will conclude in a few minutes about the whole theme of understanding death, coming into a level of comfort with our own death on the background of whatever we are studying from the 8th chapter of the Bhagavad Gita. This is a story we all know about the yaksha questions when Yudhishthira and his brothers are lost in the forest. They are very thirsty. He sent the youngest brother to fetch some water. When he does not return, he sends all the other brothers. When none of them return, he personally goes. He's about to drink the water when he hears a voice which says, unless you answer my questions, you will suffer the fate what happened to your brothers. Then they goes into a 18 question dialogue. And one of the questions which was the key to bring all his brothers back to life, the question was, what is the most unique thing in this world? And Yudhishthira replies, every one of us see death and the dying happening every day. But the most unique thing is somewhere we feel that death happens to someone else except to me. We do not factor that death can happen to me. And unless we factor it as a possibility for me, all that we are learning in the 8th chapter and the whole of Bhagavad Gita can remain more theoretical unless we begin to think that this is something that can possibly happen to me. So the art of living includes the art of dying. Somebody has said so nicely, show me a man at his death and I will tell you how he has lived. If you have really lived well, it becomes easy to die. So somewhere the key is to live a full life. There was a Jewish rabbi who lay dying and his wife bursts into tears. He looks at her and says, why are you crying? My whole life was a preparation for this moment to see how I could die. So if you have really lived well, it is not difficult to die also gracefully. We know the stories of great people who have lived full lives, like the life of Sri Ramakrishna Paramahamsa. Ramakrishna Paramahamsa had one weakness, and that was a weakness for food. Although he was treated exalted like God, he would come home to the kitchen and ask his wife every time, what have you prepared today? You know, what food is there? And his wife once looks at him with a sense of anger and says, see, out there in the temple, you are treated like God. Why are you coming here like a child asking for food? He tells her, you know, the day it is because of food, I am alive in this body. He says, the day I give up food, you know that I'm not going to survive. One day, as usual, she comes with food to him and he says no. And then she remembers that he is not going to survive for more than 3 days the day he refused food. And it so happened around the third day when he refused food, he was dying and she breaks down to tears. And he looks at her very clearly and says, this is my understanding. I am not going to die. Whatever is going to happen is about my clothes. It is my periphery. I am not going to die. This words by Sri Ramakrishna Paramahamsa was so clear to Ma Sharada Devi that she understood what Mrityorma Amritam Gamaya. She never went through the sorrow, the grieving a widow goes through when she lost her husband. She lived all her life with the feeling that Ramakrishna Paramahamsa was still alive for her. I had spoken to you about the great Sufi mystic Bayazid, and I told you some story about his life. But this is a very amazing story about his death. When he was dying, all his students gathered around him and they were surprised to see at one moment, suddenly his face becomes so radiant and had a brilliant aura. Then they asked him, Bayazid, what's happening to you? And he said, what is your last message? He said, God is welcoming me. I'm going to his embrace. And he said goodbye. And as he closed his eyes and his breathing stopped, in that moment, there seemed there was an explosion of light and the room became bright. And then it disappeared. It is said it's similar. Something happened when Bhagwan Ramana Maharshi died too. And this is the recorded experience of others who were there at the time of his death. Let me quickly recap few verses from the Bhagavad Gita that we have studied. Na jayate mriyate va kadachit nayam bhutva bhavitan va na bhuyaha ajo nityaha sashvato yam puranaha na hanyate hanyamane sharire. I do not die when this body dies. Another beautiful verse, what Sri Ramakrishna said, vasamsi jirnani yatha vihaya navani ghrinati naroparani tatha sharirani vihaya jirnani anyati samyati navani dehi. And then this verse again, nainam chindanti shastrani nainam dahati pavakaha. That is why although this body cannot be destroyed by any of the four elements. One more verse which says, those who are born certainly are going to die, and those who are die will certainly are going to really not die, because then there is no need to grieve whatsoever. What do all these verses say? Now, as long as we identify with the body goes through its prarabdha. But remember, we have been there from the very beginning, if there's a beginning, and we will be there till the very end, if there is an end. All we need to do is to disidentify from the body. Now, we see this every day. We see the sunrise and the sunset. What is our experience? The sun is like a globe. It is small. The earth is so big. The sun starts its day from the east and it comes to the west. We see the sun moving. We don't see the earth moving. And our experience is this. Once science tells you what our experience is and reality is totally different. The sun is so much more bigger than the earth. In relation to the earth and the sun, it is the spinning of the earth which gives a pseudo impression of sunset and sunrise. And because of the conviction of science, we believe, although my experience is the earth is not moving and the sun rises or the sun sets. What the Bhagavad Gita says is, the body gets old, the body falls sick, the body will die. The aging of the body is not my aging. The sickness of the body is not my sickness, and the death of my body is not my death. Now, if this can be a conviction through Shravanam, Mananam, and Nidityasanam, then the Bhagavad Gita and all that we do will be, make meaning for us. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate Om Shanti 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 Om Sarve Bhavantu Sukhinaha Sarve Santu Niramayaha Sarve Badrani Pashyantu Ma Kashchid Dukkha Bhavet Om Shanti Shanti Shanti.